Today I'm with Gavin Ward, PR manager of BMW UK. I hope I said mentioned your position properly.
PR manager.
Thank you very much for taking time.
Okay.
I would like to start to talking about your background. Before this position, which companies or places you take place in order to become the PR manager of BMW UK?
Sure, yeah, it's quite a well-worn path, I feel, because I'm not the only PR manager in the industry who's done what I've done. I used to be a journalist, so quite a few people from various car magazines have made their way on to being PR managers, if you like, so sort of what we call poacher turned gamekeeper. So, yes, I've been at BMW for about 8 years now, but first as a junior, and then sort of rose up and sort of now PR manager. Prior to that, I was on Auto Express magazine for just under 5 years, sort of general news and features, road tests, a bit of everything. And prior to that, I was on what I was called a proper journalist. So I used to work on newspapers, so from court reporting to sort of war stories. Went out to Kosovo during the crisis over there and a few things. So it was actually generally a very interesting time. And prior to that, quite a bit of travel and a bit of marketing work at an agency and a few other things. So, but yeah, compared to my peers, most of us have done some form of journalism before or a PR degree, and I did the journalism bit first and then crossed over.
That's excellent. This I would like to jump to the BMW. This year was quite exciting for BMW fans. BMW introduced a new 3 series, I models, M5, M6, new 6 series, and recently the new 3 turbo diesel models, engines. And could you tell us about their diversifying characteristics compared to the other vehicles?
Sure, I mean the reason that the range exists as it is now and will be set to continue. I mean, you have to look back at where we were before. BMW historically was 3 Series, 5 Series and 7. There was the odd car here and there, a Z1 or something along those lines, a little bit special. But invariably the range was popular, but it was limited, if you like, in terms of its appeal. Over the years, obviously, customers want greater diversity. They want the car that really does suit their needs, not maybe this one that's a slight compromise in terms of space or styling. And factor in the other thing is most people who leave the brand isn't because they don't like what we're doing, or they literally are quote bored. They've had three series coupes and they fancy something different. So if you can actually offer them something different, then they always stay within the brand, which is why we have such an explosion in model ranges over the last few years. So 1 series, 3 series, 5, 6, and it goes on. At the moment, we have about 21 different body styles, BMW alone. And that's before we get into things, as you mentioned before, triple turbo diesel engines, Project I. Well, obviously that's a completely new range of vehicles that will come out. So the it will set to continue, and the idea being that we will be a total mobility provider, because obviously we do, as you're probably well aware, offer motorbikes, we obviously have pedal car bikes, there's a whole range of things here going forward, electric vehicles. So in the future, the idea being that somebody would be able to have a luxury car for the weekend, a bike for the city. They're connected with My City Way and all these other things that help them sort of get around what would be a megapolis. So the whole joined up nation of travel, if you like, we won't just be a car provider in the oldest sense of the word. We'll offer a far greater diversity of travel options for you.
So in future, a BMW enthusiast can buy any type of car which will fit his demands.
Great. I mean, if you think now the range between the BMW group as a whole, we have Mini, which we've had now since 10, 11 years. We've also had Rolls Royce, which is a complete other end of the scale. Project I is very much a future way of transport, if you like, so a totally electric power or a range extender. Then you have your traditional BMW buyer, which we don't feel wants to alienate what we're doing, which is why we always push the sporty side of things too, because that's your traditional buyer. But we're offering even down to the options on a particular car. So on the new 3 Series that you mentioned, we now have a lines package. So in addition to ESSE and M Sport, which we've always had, we now have Sport, Urban and Luxury. And the idea being that the modern side, if you like, sorry, not Urban, is that the modern side is it should appeal to buyers of, say, a Lexus or a Volvo, because it's not something they would normally do. It's a bit more sort of harmonious, it's a bit more sort of subtle in terms of its color and hues and specifications. So even on that level, not just in terms of actual full-on product range, but actually the detail of the product range is very much aimed at different people too. But the idea being that we're trying to appeal to a lot of people.
The new 3 Series, as I just saw the new models downstairs, so Urban, Sports, Luxury, all of them has a different characteristics.
Certainly, yes, in terms of look and feel. So, I should correct myself, it's urban on one series and it's modern on three series. But each of those, the lines package, if you like, is something that we'll introduce some other models to in the future, for the very reason that it gives customers something they want. Invariably, we always listen to what customers want, and people come back and say, I fancy this, but with that, and actually you can offer them the benefits of that, then great, that's, you know, that's almost like that personalized service. So we're basically the customer first.
Excellent. And I just want to, when you talk about the i-series, I think many people know that BMW has the lowest CO2 level in the on the range for their products. So it's, I think, and I recently drove an X6 and it was the start-stop system was working flawless. Is the start-stop system, all these technologies, are they available in whole range?
It's something that rolls out, and obviously model ranges, most model cycles are about 7 years. So there are models that over time, things will get introduced, if you like. So we have 8-speed gearboxes now for automatics on a lot of the models. Some cars that don't have that at the moment because of where they are in their life cycle. Same with auto start-stop, but it is something that will eventually, I mean, an M3 has auto start-stop, for example. So even your high-performance vehicles can have some of those sort of what we call efficient dynamics applications, which basically don't detract from the driving experience and the performance side of things, but they really do aid the CO2 and in terms of your MPG consumption figures as well.
That's excellent for. And I would like to ask two questions that many people wonder about that. Actually, I was wondering for many years. Why BMW does not offer the M7? Because when you look at the competitors, there's Mercedes S-Class AMG 63, 65, Audi offers S8, but BMW never offered the M7, it's always 760. Is there a strategy behind this?
Partly a strategic decision. Sometimes just because somebody else is doing it doesn't mean say we want to follow suit. We tend to sort of plow our own furrow to some degree. Yes, I'm sure there are some people who probably quite like an M7. I think overall, though, the emphasis isn't, because I think if you think the biggest markets for 7 Series aren't necessarily the biggest markets for M cars. And just in general, in terms of the ethos of what a 7 Series is, it's a, you know, it's a luxury car. So if you want the performance and the luxury, then yeah, 760 Li, which is a twin turbo V12, is plenty fast enough. Probably could wear the M badge if it wanted to, but we choose not to, because for us, M is a different kind of performance in terms of what it's actually offering. That said, we never say never. Who's to say that in a few years' time an M badge might appear? But actually, as we stand now, then no, there won't be an M7. Our M range with the introduction of M performance is increasing anyway, and there are more M cars coming this year. We've seen a concept M135i, which looks quite close to the real vehicle. It's no surprise that there'll be an M6 at some stage this year, coupe and convertible. And we've just announced another M3, a limited edition M3 in the UK. So there's always a growth, there's always an interest in M, but maybe not for every single vehicle.
And what about the 8 Series? 2 decades ago, I remember the 8 Series, the huge GT Coupe. Mm-hmm. And after that, BMW never produced the car again. There were some rumors it will be coming soon, but it became the part in the museums or in our minds.
Yeah, it's an interesting one, because I think it's maybe down to nomenclature, because basically there isn't an 8 Series, you're correct, but actually there is a 6 Series. So now there's 3 different body styles of 6 Series. So we have obviously a coupe and convertible, and then the new, which we've never done before, is a coupe, grand coupe, sorry. So that grand coupe, the positioning of it, and also the standard specification, the feel of it, is very much, you could call it an 8 Series, I mean, if we wanted to. We chose not to, we had to call it a 6 Series grand coupe. So that kind of car does exist, certainly in the UK. I mean, some people buy the 650i version, but really most people go for the 640d. And actually, as a grand touring vehicle for long distances, actually would be pretty much perfect for it.
Yeah, actually it's a great car. I drove the previous model. And I would like to jump to the social media. BMW is quite active on the social media through Twitter, Facebook and other instruments. How do you see this influence on the BMW, and does it make any positive or negative impact on the BMW, the engagement of social media?
Certainly, I mean, if you're not in social media, you certainly should be, and we are, so we definitely see the benefits of it. On a personal level, from a PR manager's point of view, it allows me to monitor what's going on. So there's two sides to social media. You can put things out there which are new and interesting and offer people such as yourself insights into an engineering something or other that we've just done. The flip side is I'm going to find out what you guys are all up to. And also, generally you get a barometer of what other people are saying about your brand as well, which also helps shape some degree your thoughts going forwards, because obviously, you know, you're not pleasing people, there's an issue, you need to know about it. So social media is hugely important, we are engaged in it. And it's a very good way to build a very loyal fan base. So BMW Facebook has now just passed, I think, 9 million people who are sort of subscribe up to it. Yeah, it has a huge following.
It's more than a country.
Exactly. So it's very popular. We do our own stuff. I do my own Twittering, if you like, to sort of push some things out there. I have about 3,000 followers now. So there is interest in that type of thing. And people always want content. And they always want something new and different. And actually, in the grand set piece of a launch or an unveil of a car, there's usually lots of stories behind that, which actually maybe don't get the coverage in a mainstream magazine. But actually online, there is a way of linking up and making it more interesting. So we're very much behind social media. So we have Empower websites, we have our own YouTube channel, Facebook, Twitter. So yeah, kind of got the main bases covered already.
And does the social media increase the sales of the cars? Did you measure something like that? Does it have that kind of impact?
So I mean, it's like anything. If you have good coverage or bad coverage, it all adds, you know, or detracts from what you're doing. So very much so. I mean, if you have a some people are waging a campaign against you online because they've had bad customer service, then you need to know about it. And hopefully the best thing about being part of the discussion, if you like, is being able to help feedback. Because most people's frustrations, if they don't get what they want initially, or find out what they want rather, is because they just haven't had somebody hasn't had the chance to speak to them. Social media allows that instant sort of response, to feel that somebody's listening, and actually obviously the next step is to take it forward and try and resolve whatever's going on. Flip side is obviously something that's beneficial. We have fans on Facebook and things. You can actually organise special events for them. That's what we've done too. So, you know, the quid pro quo is some people have a very good touch point with us and actually get to go to some great things purely based on being a fan of the website or subscribing up to something.
That's amazing. And I would like to ask something about the Brutus. It became popular after Top Gear.
Sure, yeah.
I knew it before that it was the car engineering, top point of the car engineering, maybe I can define. But can you describe about that car? Was it a production or concept or just...
Well, the history behind it is, like a lot of these things, we have quite a rich history engineering background in terms of engine development. BMW obviously started out aero engines and making motorbikes, and progressed on that through to motor vehicles. We've done marine engines over the years for powerboats and things. So. A lot of different engineering expertise has been applied in different ways. With Brutus in particular, it was a byproduct of the First World War, where Germany wasn't allowed to produce any aircraft following the end of the war. And so there was a lot of spare parts, if you like, and engines sitting around. And clearly some engineers had some time on their hands, so they fitted the I think it was a 46-litre engine to the chassis of maybe even an undercarriage of a plane or something, and to actually make it work. It's not necessarily fits in with our current efficient dynamics model. So I think it does about 0.2 to the gallon, miles to the gallon. But yes, it's one of those sort of anomalies from very on in the era of motoring, whereby you had sort of 20, 30, 40 litre cars, and you know, just because of the things that were lying around at the time. But yes, it's not something we'd probably bring back now.
Yeah. And lastly, what car do you drive?
I'm lucky enough to have a couple of cars over the year to how our company car scheme works. So currently I drive an X5. Because I'm a family man and it suits the purpose on that. So I have anyone with children will know you need lots of space, and usually something bigger than things you can chuck stuff in the back. So yes, I have an X5 with 3-liter D, which is perfect. So.
Single turbo.
Yes, just the single. Single's enough for me. It's enough.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.